Well, welcome back again for part three of our webinar series brought to you by Shambaugh&Sons, the industry leader in the design and installation of fire suppression and fire protection systems. We are licensed in 50 states. We are building America's infrastructure, whether it be distribution centers or stadiums or corporate complexes or airports or towers such as Nashville, where we're doing mixed commercial use, or whether it is advanced manufacturing facilities such as semiconductor plants or electric vehicle assembly plants or electric vehicle battery plants, where we are recycling batteries or manufacturing and producing batteries for the electric vehicle industry. So we're on the cutting edge of technology. We've got 2,700 individuals that are out in the field installing these piping systems. We're specialized pipe fitters. And then we have another 200 to 300 plus engineers and designers, in addition to hundreds of individuals that work in the shops and our fabrication facilities. We have 80 tractor trailers on the road that are delivering the product to and from the job site. So let's kick into our third part of this webinar, and I want to talk about what we offer. And this is in collaboration with our union. We are a union contractor. We are a union contractor. So what that means is we follow the collective bargaining agreement. So Shambaugh&Sons is a signatory contractor. So we work closely with Local 669 to train, develop our workforce. In addition to that, we allow Local 669 to negotiate with ourselves and our other contractors, and 669 has about 1,000 signatory contractors, wages, benefits, and that includes retirement plans. So that's really important to Shambaugh&Sons. And you look at the world that we live in today, where you see, you know, it's us versus them. And yes, unions are in the business to protect the worker, to ensure they're being treated properly, they're being paid fairly, there's no wage theft. But our chief operating officer of a billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar company is a 669 member and has over 35 years and cut his teeth in the trade, walking the iron, and is a sprinkler fitter. Our superintendents, and I outlined how our organization is structured throughout the country, our superintendents that are running the job sites and leading the teams are all union members. So we work very closely together to ensure that we are protecting our workforce, because that's the most important thing, is our people executing and performing properly, because we're putting in a life safety system that our customers and our communities are counting on us to install properly. And we're ensuring through the collective bargaining agreement that we are taking care of our people. So we already talked about where we came from the Garment Triangle Shirtwaist Fire. We talked about what a registered apprenticeship is, and that's in part two. And we talked about the history of unions and where the growth came from, and our trade starting with the Garment Triangle Shirtwaist Fire. So under the collective bargaining agreement, there are really three main components. Number one is a living wage. And what is a living wage? So to me, it means at the end of the month, you have money left over when all the bills are paid. That's what it means. So it doesn't mean at the end of the month, you have to decide which bill doesn't get paid because you don't have enough money. Right. So we know that the cost of living, the cost of housing, the cost of food, the cost of transportation, the cost of technology has gone up over 30% in the last, 10 to 15 years. You know, and in wages in general, the United States, blue collar wages have not gone up. You know, the top 10% of earners, their wages have gone up 30%. The majority, it's only gone up 14%. So that's why it's important to have a union, because as we looked at the collective bargaining process and we go back to that sequoia tree, we understand that you're not doing this on your own. You're not negotiating your wages on your own. There's 16,000 members in Local 669. There's 1,000 signatory contractors. And oh, by the way, most of them are ran by union members. You know, so we work together on that. So let's talk about that, right? You know, what we offer, Shambaugh&Sons, is we're doing mega projects. And we hire travelers. Travelers are individuals that they don't work around their house. They work on mega projects. It could be a county away. They could be on the other side of the state. They could be in another state. Right? So we maximize our resources and we focus on these large projects so we can get them done. And we have economies of scale that enable us to compete and deliver for our customers. But we pay overtime after 8 hours. That's something really important. Overtime after eight. So this is not a case of a career where at the end of the week, the supervisor says, hey, I want you to clock out because you're close to 40 hours a week. Why do they do that? So they don't have to pay overtime. Anything on a daily basis that's over 8 hours is paid overtime. Anything on a Saturday is time and a half. Anything on a Sunday is double time. We pay per diem. So if you're going to be away from your family or away from home and you're 100 miles away from home, then we pay $840 a week in per diem. Whether you choose to pull a trailer, whether you choose to live in a motorhome and hook up for $50 a week, whether you choose to split a hotel room with another apprentice or another journey level worker, you're getting paid $840 a week. When we work on mega projects, think about the size and scope of Ford Blue Oval City, of Samsung in Taylor, Texas, of Taiwanese Semiconductor in Arizona, of Panasonic in Kansas. It is costing our customer money to build these facilities. A lot of money, a lot of capital, and that money's tied up. Until they get throughput out the back end of their product or their widget, their car, their microchip, they're not making money on it. So they want it done yesterday, right? And we do it safely, but we are on a very aggressive pace to deliver for our customers. And we pay our people to do that. So our team typically is going to get between 10 to 20 hours a week in overtime on a weekly basis, plus the per diem, plus we pay mileage. And then we have the union wage. So I want to give you an example of this and to break this down, right? We have wage schedules all over the country, right? So, I mean, you can agree with me that the cost of living in Alabama is a lot different than it is in Yonkers, New York, or a lot different than it is in Chicago Metro, right? Taxes are higher, the cost of food, the cost of housing is different depending on where you live. So I'm going to use one example, right? Because we have a wage schedule that is all, you know, we've got a wage schedule for in California, four different wage schedules, in New York State, four different wage schedules, right? Because the cost of living in White Plains is a lot different than it is in Watertown, New York, as an example. Okay, so we're going to use one example. Kentucky wage, the base rate, the starting wage is $18.95 an hour, right? 40 hours a week, that's $758 in the check. If working 20 hours a week in overtime, that's an additional $568.50 in the check for that week. We pay per diem, right? That's for food and lodging, $840 for the week. Mileage reimbursement, I'm not even including that, but there's a mileage reimbursement as well. So the total for week one, this is the start. This is an individual that hasn't even done anything yet on the job site, right? Well, they have. They worked at 40 hours, right? But they don't know the trade yet. Week one, their take home in the check is $2,166. Now remember, in our apprenticeship program, under our collective bargaining agreement, our apprentices that keep up with their lessons, every 6 months during the apprenticeship, they get a 5% pay increase. And every year they're getting an additional pay increase. That's a cost of living increase. That's three pay increases every single year until that apprentice journeys out. So let's do the math on this and annualize this for the state of Kentucky. After the first year, that individual, 19 years old maybe, right? One of your students in your CTE program, or maybe not even in the CTE program, after the first year, in the check is $108,000. Second year, because of the 5% pay increases, $120,000. Third year, $135,000. Fourth year, $149,720. And in the fifth year, $174,000, right? Incremental pay increases, right? And the math that I'm using is continuing to work 20 hours of overtime a week, right? And then the journey level worker here is $186,470. Right? So I use the math with a couple weeks off in there as well, right? So I'm not using 52 weeks, right? So I want you to think about this road to success, right? And really the life skills and what we're trying to teach our young women and men today, right? Is to have a great career where they're happy and they have the opportunity, right? To live, to have a living wage. So at the end of the week, at the end of the month, they can pay those bills and have money left over. These numbers that I'm sharing with you, that's a living wage. The average income for a dual household family in the United States is $50,000. And look what our first year apprentices, when they travel, Shambaugh&Sons, are making. Right? These are game changers. Now, I kept saying in the check, and what I mean by that is another exit or detour in the United States today, right? And we're seeing it. We saw it with the UPS, with the Teamsters. We saw it, and we're seeing it with the UAW. One of the things that they're really focused on is temp labor, right? These are full-time careers with us. And full-time careers brings benefits, right? A temp or somebody that's only working 30 hours a week or 20 hours a week, they don't get benefits. And I'm talking medical, dental, vision, prescription, and eyeglass benefits. Those are provided to our members, right? To our union members. And again, Shambaugh&Son is a union contractor. So our specialized pipe fitters and fire protection are getting 100% benefits. Now, I want to tell you a story. A buddy of mine, he's a 669 member, right? He's in the Northeast. And unfortunately, he came down with a virus and he had COVID. He spent 71 days in the hospital because of this virus, right? And he battled back, is currently working again. He's back to work. His out-of-pocket medical expense for those 70 plus days in the hospital was $2,500. That's because of the union, his benefit package. He didn't lose his house. He didn't lose his family. He didn't lose his entire life savings. And he returned to work making the exact same money that he left before he came down with the virus. That's why I say in the check. A benefit is on top of the check. A benefit is a benefit. It's not, I'm going to make $18.95 an hour and the benefits cost me five. Well, at the end of the day, you're making $13.95 an hour, right? That's not really a benefit. You're paying for your own health care. That's what that is. So those are really two main things: living wage, benefits for our members and families. And then the third thing that we offer is the opportunity to retire with dignity. Now, if you're like me, you know someone that's in their 70s that's working because they have to. Not because they want to, but because they have to. So in the check is the wage that you get paid. The benefits are on top of that. medical, dental, vision, prescription, eyeglass benefits, and then there's another couple lines that have to do with retirement. The only thing better than one retirement fund is two. We have two. Here's the first one. No matter where you work, as a 669 member and working as a sprinkler fitter, apprentice, journey level worker with Shambaugh&Sons, you're going to get $135 a month for every year you work. If someone works for 40 years, 40 times 135 is $5,400 a month. You multiply that by 12, that's close to $65,000 a year after you retire. The life expectancy, 80 years old, that's another 20 years. Do the math, 20 years times 64,800, that's close to $1.3 million. That's what that pension fund is worth. Now, when I started recruiting a little over 5 years ago, that number was $115 a month. So if you're an apprentice or your students are apprentices, when they journey out and when they retire, that number will not be 135, it's going to be higher. And I can't wait. The only thing better than one retirement plan is two. In Kentucky, right, we have wages all over, and the members in each district, okay, for the union, they vote on how much money is going to go into the retirement. In Kentucky, $7.01 an hour is going into a second retirement that's called a SIS. It's like a 401k. So let's do some math here, right? And I made some adjustments, and you take a picture of this and you play around with the numbers that you want to use, right? So we're using this just to show you, number one, the value of this pension fund. And number two, really, the value, and this is a life skill to teach your students, is invest consistently and over time what compounding interest does. So 701 per hour times 60 hours times 50 weeks in a year. So only working 50 weeks, that's $21,000 times 40 years, that's $841,200, right? In your own retirement fund that you didn't have to invest a single dime. Right, you can have your other retirement on top of this, but this is a benefit. Compounding interest. Over the last 30 years, the average compounding interest for retirement accounts has been 7%. That compounding interest, and we're missing a couple zeros there, it's not $4,125. It's $4,125,000. $4 million, Specialized Pipefitter, right? So the importance of compounding interest in time, I want you to see that $21,030 times 30 years, that's $630,900 instead of $841,000. But more importantly, on a compounding interest over 30 years versus 40, it's $1.9 million, $1,985,943. Right, so there is a big difference there, that extra 10 years, right? That's why fitters continue to work, because we have the opportunity to retire with dignity, right? That's the red pill. You don't fail into construction, right? The only way to be successful is to get a white collar job and a 4-year degree. That's a blue pill, right? Here's another way to look at it. When your students' peers, if they join us right after high school, when their peers graduate from college, they're going to hope to get a job. They're going to have debt. Okay? Our individuals will have already earned $513,295, and they're 22 years old. And they earn 45 college credits and don't incur any debt at all. You don't fail into construction. But you know what? It's more than the money, right? So if you or your students or your team is going to chase the money, then it's not going to work, right? This is really hard work, right? But it's more than the money. It's essential work, right? During the pandemic, okay, we worked. You know, during the heart of the pandemic, we had unemployment about 25 to 30%. A couple months later, it was 15%. And then 5 months into this, we had less than 8% unemployment, right? We're a trade that's always working. 669, my gosh, you know, we've got less than 50 individuals out of 16,000 that are currently unemployed. And there's a reason for that, you know, medical issues and, you know, some different time off. It's more than the money. You know, we're working on major infrastructure. We're working on creating systems and advanced manufacturing and creating opportunities that reduce the carbon footprint, you know, to help us to get to net carbon zero, right? This is construction 2023, you know, automated racking systems and different robotics and, you know, the world that we live in today. And I think it's more than the money, because your students like to use their hands. They like to have job satisfaction at the end of the day and say, this is what I accomplished, right? This is not theory based, right? There's a sense of accomplishment at the end of every single day. And what's great and what I love about being part of the union and being part of the Shambaugh team is it's a family, right? My background, I was in the Marine Corps, and that was my tribe. You know, Semper Fidelis, there's an esprit de corps, right? And that's what's great about the building trades, is that there is a team. That's what's great about being a union member, right? You are that sequoia tree. You're not there by yourself, right? So it's more than the money, right? We're not the remote people. We're out there kneecap to kneecap with our brothers and sisters in the union, our brothers and sisters with our great company, Shambaugh&Sons. So I want to show just a quick video here, and you know, as we transition this presentation, I want to just add these videos in here so you get more visuals. This video here, you're going to see the drone is going to fly through, and I want you to notice that typically we go in when the envelope of the building is up, okay? So the floors have been poured, right? But the building has not been finished. It's not enclosed. So the envelope is up. You can see that the steel is in. And we go in right before the tin knockers or the sheet metal workers go in, right? So that's typically when we go in a schedule. So we're just flying the zoom, flying the drone. You can see all this piping, right? This is fire protection, right? The size of those fittings. You notice these aerial lifts and everything is up. You notice up here, you have pipe hangers, right? So every day is different, right? Every pipe is connected to a larger pipe, right? So that's a piping system where we have headers that are connected to branch lines, and off the branch lines you can see the sprinkler heads that are popping down, and you can see all these other pipe hangers, right? So this is inside a facility in upstate New York. You can see all the fire suppression lines, right? Continue to run those into another part of the building. I'm waiting to pour the floors here. Right. So again, we typically go in right before the sheet metal workers go in. And we take precedence by fire code and by law. All right, so let's watch another video. I want you to see the size and scope of some of these large mega projects, right? That will blow you away. This is happening today in America. This is happening, being built today in America, right? We're on the move. You know, this is a millennial build, a millennial time frame in construction in the United States today, and it's not going to back off anytime soon. You know, maybe residential construction is down because of the interest rates, but we're up. We've had an increase in our backlog over the last 3 to 4 months of about 30%. And a lot of that has to do with national security, has to do with the chip bill, and has to do with the infrastructure bill. So let's watch a couple videos, and I want you to just key in on the size and scope of some of these facilities. All right, this is Intel that's in Hillsboro, which is outside of Portland. This is Chandler, Arizona, another Intel facility that we'll be doing.
You don't really get a glimpse of the scale.
Expansion of what's going 5.2. On this is inside one of the semiconductor plants.
And Ever says Ohio's operation is going to
right?
be even
Columbus, Ohio has got a $100 billion build. This is Ford Blue Oval City, outside of Memphis and Standard.
Kentucky, we're building two co-located battery plants in partnership with SK Innovation.
We're building battery plants all over the country. This is a Tesla facility in Round Rock, Texas. I want you to just see and look at the size and scope of this building. These are the types of projects that we do. Look at all the aerial lifts. This is Micron, the renderings of Micron that's going into Syracuse, New York. A $100 billion build is going to add close to 55,000 jobs.
Micron is now building another mega factory in central New York at a whopping $100 billion. The Idaho-based computer chip maker's announcement for this New York factory comes 1 month after it announced plans for a new semiconductor fab in Boise. Micron manufactures the chips that powers everything from smartphones to computers to automobiles. And these products used to be manufactured abroad, primarily in China, until Congress passed the $280 billion Chips and Science Act, which set aside $52 billion to bolster the semiconductor industry. Now, Micron announced in September that the new semiconductor plant will create 17,000 jobs here in Boise, and New York may see up to 50,000 jobs.
Okay, that's a facility, Cree. They make chips for the electric vehicle industry. So, I mean, we're doing Panasonic, Samsung, you name it. A lot of distribution centers as well. I mean, these are large, you know, cold storage facilities. That's in our wheelhouse. Amazon facilities, Walmart distribution centers. They're massive. This is a DHL distribution center. Kind of a neat video. You know, we're going to go all the way back to the operating engineers being out there. So I want you to look at the piping. I want you to look at the size of the piping. I want you to just look at the height, and I want you to just look at the intricate piping systems that we have that we're currently installing. Little jump there. Threading a lot of pipe, grooving a lot of pipe with the size of those fittings. And an aerial lift. Eight fabrication facilities around the country. 200 engineers and designers in over 13 locations across the United States. Been around again since 1926. You'll find on our website case studies where you can learn more about the size and scope, the different industries that we impact, and the work that we performed in, whether it be arenas or advanced manufacturing, mixed use. Again, we are licensed in all 50 states. And we have programs for transitioning veterans, programs for National Guard members, reservists. About 30% of our membership are veterans, but the other 70% is not. You know, so these opportunities are for everyone. You know, we've increased our enrollment of women coming into our trade for with Shambaugh&Sons by 78% in the last year. I mean, we're really excited about that, and you know, our sisters in the brotherhood are out there performing and you know, making a name for themselves as well.
If someone told me construction was a man's job, I would say what I've always said, which is absolutely not. Women can do anything a man can do. I can do anything a man can do.
Anything that my brothers or my dad could do, I can do it.
So what do unions mean by wage equity?
It seems like there's more and more of us out there.
It means an apprentice one, whether they are a woman or a man,
and use their minds in different ways.
Paid the exact same.
All across the nation, infrastructure, property, and lives are protected thanks to the work of well-trained and highly skilled sprinkler fitters.
Including higher education.
We're currently seeking motivated women from all backgrounds to join our apprenticeship program.
That's part of our social
learning
justice
the skills
mission.
Needed to start a rewarding
That's
career as a sprinkler
from.
Fitter.
Garment,
honestly, I thought fires. It was sprinklers, like ground sprinklers.
You know,
oh, you mean like fire
cents
sprinklers?
And, a man was paid
and they were
a dollar.
Like, yeah, it's an apprenticeship,
and
so it's not just a job, it's a career.
In a sweatshop, $146.
We'll train you to install and maintain fire protection systems, including commercial and industrial structures, power plants, hospitals, factories, and more.
I think that a sprinkler fitter helps the firefighters out in the sense that we're kind of the first line of defense.
It's a means of exiting safely if and when there happens to be a fire.
This is challenging work, often done in the air, on ladders or lifts. If this sounds like your type of career, there has never been a better time to consider an apprenticeship in the sprinkler fitting trade.
So it's a 5-year apprenticeship program?
So. This is Anna. She is our training instructor in Portland. She's also a former from a great company called McKinstry. And Shambaugh&Sons has a lot of respect for that great organization. And this is Anna working out at an Intel facility in Hillsboro. It's my sister working up in for Patriot Fire Protection in Spokane. I graduated skilled trades prep in Spokane, Washington. Thank you, Kenna May and the OG. And there's Jen Cross, who's up in the aerial lift. Jen graduated from Oregon Tradeswomen and also works for McKinstry. So I want to thank you for joining me for the third part of our webinar series, and I look forward to seeing you for part 4.